Good morning, everybody. I spent the very first day of my PhD here in Les Houches on a workshop, so I think it's a nice coincidence that I'm here again now. I'm going to speak, like Andrea said, about my PhD, which turned out to be three little projects, but I don't have enough time to speak about all of them, so I'm going to speak about the two most important ones. I'll start with a very, very quick motivation. Lars has already explained a lot of the background, so I'm happy about that. See here. Oh, there you are. Then I'll speak about deformation experiments I've performed in the viscous flow regime, mostly focusing on dislocations, and later about a set of deformation in, investigating the frictional strength of rocks. I'm mostly interested in the lithospheric mantle, so the layer just in between the rigid lithosphere and the ductilely deforming asthenosphere, and to understand how convection in the mantle can be a driving factor and how it can yield moving tectonic plates. We have to understand this important mechanical coupling layers in between the brittle and rigid lithosphere and the ductile deforming asthenosphere. To jump directly into my first project, let me put this on, let's see here. I've been deforming polycrystalline olivine there since polycrystalline or olivine is the most common element in the upper mantle. So this olivine starts as natural samples from St. Carlos in the United States. It's been pulverized to a grain size around 2 micrometers, then cold pressed just to compact the powder, in a later step hot pressed to sinter the grain boundaries and fabricate a dense polycrystal. I'm deforming those samples at two temperatures, 1000 degrees Celsius and 1200 degrees Celsius, at confining pressures of 300 MPa and a constant ramp rate, which translates to roughly strain rate of 10 to the minus 5 per second. All of that is done in an internally heated in-situ deformation apparatus called Patterson press. It's a long chain of words. It's basically a pressure cooker. So you subject the samples to high temperature, high pressure, and deform them meanwhile. What normally looks like when you do those experiments is here plotted the stress versus strain. So this is the mechanical data, and you have two different kind of regimes. One time when you deform at high temperatures, so in the case of olivine, let's say above about 1,100 degrees Celsius, you have an initial phase where stress increases with strain and then quickly becomes independent from strain. You reach a plateau, which is often called the mechanical steady state. On the other hand, at low temperatures, let's say below 1,100 degrees Celsius, you have a much more significant increase of stress with finite strain, until at one point your stress becomes so high that your sample normally fails. So you might reach a steady state regime somewhere further up, but normally we don't achieve it in the experiments. The big question I have now is, okay, we see the stress going up with the ongoing experiments, so somehow the samples are becoming harder, but the question is how? What does actually happen inside of the samples that makes them harder? What changes in the microstructure? So that's how my samples look like. Again, it's the mechanical data, so the stress versus finite strain on the left-hand side for all the samples deformed at 1,000 degrees Celsius, and on the right-hand side at 1,200 degrees Celsius. You can immediately see the difference in achieved stresses. So the maximum stress at 1,200 degrees, at high temperatures, about 320 MPa, and at low temperature, above 1,110 MPa. The other difference you can see, in the hot case, we achieve near steady state, we're getting close, after about 9% of finite strain, while in the low temperature case, there's only one curve which looks like steady state. Keep in mind, it's probably not. I'm going to show you in about one, two slides why. Other than that, I have to notice again that my confining pressure is here at 300 MPa. So in the case of the low temperature samples, we're actually exceeding the confining pressure by more than 800 MPa, and the sample is still going on. If you take, so Lars has been speaking about the transient creep regime, and that's exactly the novel thing I'm trying to do here. What people have been normally doing when they are running experiments is running them into the steady state regime, and the logic for that is that it might allow you to compare samples between different labs, between different setups and so on. And for the first time, I've been doing or running experiments that stop at a certain value of finite strain, so at different points in this evolution of the mechanical data and hopefully also in the evolution of microstructure. if you take the maximum stresses achieved in all of those experiments, so you take the endpoints from all of those colorful curves, and you plot it against literature data, it looks something like this. Here is the stress against temperature. The solid and dashed lines are flow loss from the literature, and they are from single crystals. And this is all the data at 1000 degrees Celsius, so just low temperature samples. The red dots are my experiments. So going up, you go towards steady state, but you're not reaching steady state yet. And what you will see is that my points dot at higher stresses than most of the flow loss, except maybe the one from Thielke, but that one is a maximum estimate. It's giving only the hardest glide direction. So even that one, even the maximum estimate, we are surpassing by a little bit. But that's okay, because I am deforming polycrystalline samples. Those flow loss are for single crystal. And having incompatibilities between the grains just makes it harder to deform your sample. So we see higher stresses, but that's also what we expect. Now, the big question is, like I showed you, the stress increases, your sample gets harder. How does that happen? So let's have a look at the microstructure. The first thing to do is put your sample, cut it, polish it, put it in a regular scanning electron microscope. And that's images you get from the SEM. And just qualitatively speaking, by looking at them, you see the grains are slightly elongated with aspect ratios of around 1.4 or 1.5. You have a lot of small grains with minimum sizes of 0.5 micrometers and a few big grains of up to 60 micrometers in some cases. Now, bottom left side is the initial starting material that is undeformed. In the middle is the one sample at 1,200 degrees to the highest strain, so the one where we expect the most change. And on the right-hand side is the same highest strain, but deformed at 1,000 degrees Celsius. And if we zoom into this one a little bit more, and that's the one where I said it's probably not deforming in steady state, although it has a plateau, we see a lot of cracks. So I'm not sure how well you can see it, but there's a few different grains here. And in those grains, you can see nice cracks at a 60 degree angle that run through the whole grain and sometimes even cross grain boundaries. So that's a hint, or maybe even evidence, that this sample was actually deforming by microfracturing. So we're not in a purely ductile regime anymore. So what looks like mechanical steady state in the graph is microfracturing. Now, apart from the SEM, we can also utilize the EBSD, and the EBSD basically gives you the orientation of the crystal lattice at each point in a raster. So I've plotted here the misorientation to the mean of each grain. Basically, what this map is telling you, the more dark blue the colors are, the less misorientated your grains are, so the less deformed they probably are. And the more you go to the red, the more misorientated your sample are, and the more deformed they probably are. Again, just qualitatively speaking, we see evidences for grain boundary migration, so bulging of grain boundaries. We see that smaller grains appear to have a lower misorientation, so the smaller the grain, normally the more dark blue you see. And we see, well, just usual hints for samples that are not in a steady state yet. We see curved and serrated subgrain boundaries, gradual misorientation. We see subgrain boundaries forming nice cells, or basically in all parts of the development, from gradual misorientation to well-defined subgrain boundaries. And just as a little shout out, to my knowledge, we achieved for the first time to do maps with a step size of 0.05 micrometers, so we're pretty proud about that, which is a very high resolution. If you want to have even higher resolution, you can use the TEM, so that's two TEM images. And here you can nicely see this heterogeneity in the grain size that I was just speaking about. On the top, you have a small grain with just one single dislocation. Maybe sometimes they're even free of dislocations. And on the bottom, you see a bigger grain, which is virtually full of dislocations. So in this case, it's about 7 times 10 to the 13 per square meter. So a very high concentration of dislocations. Other than that, we see just the regular things that we expect. Dislocations gliding into perpendicular slip systems in E1 and C direction. And a little bit more unusually, sometimes grain boundaries acting as dislocation sources. So in this case here, you have a dislocation source with very low activity of just free loops. But it's not often that we see that. You have to search for it. Now, I've been speaking mostly qualitatively now. Let's get a bit more quantitative. I've plotted you here the grain size distributions on the left-hand side for the undeformed starting material, on the right-hand side for the one sample where we expect the most change. So the one deformed at the highest temperature to the highest strain. The solid lines are just the grain size distributions, and the colorful bars are averaged by area. So what you can see directly is you have mostly small grains with a mean grain size of around 1.4 to 1.6 micrometers, and then a few big grains, but those few big grains make up a roughly equal part of the grain area, of the sample area. Now, if you just compare the two without getting too much into details, you'll probably agree with me that they look pretty similar. So the one sample where we expect the most change and the starting material look pretty similar. And that holds true for no matter what we do. I don't have time enough to show you all the evidence, but we looked at everything we could. We looked at the subgrain boundary spacing, at the tortuosity of the grain boundaries, length of grain boundaries, the grain orientation spread, everything we could get our hands on. And the message stays the same if you compare all the different samples. So in this case, those plots are for aspect ratio, grain orientation spread, and a grain size. And on the x-axis, you just have different samples, so all of them with different strains and temperatures. No matter, it's roughly the same in between the samples. So the observations that we see in those deformation experiments is that, I didn't show you, but we form a very weak CPO. We have no significant change in texture and microstructure, although our samples are hardening a lot. Also, we do have evidences for dislocation creep a bit more. Maybe if you have questions for that, ask me after the talk. And also a strongly heterogeneous density of dislocations in between the small and the big grains. So we've come up with a few hypotheses of how to explain this difference. Because mostly from metals or from the material sciences, we know that the hardening was or should be explained with an increase in dislocation density, what they call the dislocation forest. Why don't we see this in olivine? What's different? And a few of the hypotheses are that in olivine, the dislocations glide into a perpendicular slip system, so the interactions between them are actually weak, which may lead to just the dislocation density not increasing since we have effective recovery mechanisms, or since they just don't block each other. Then the lattice friction might be low in high temperature samples, but it's really difficult for us to prove that in our images. And since the grain size is really small with only 2 micrometers, we have a high ratio between the grain boundary area and the grain surface. So grain boundaries should be important and should probably act as obstacles, dislocation sources, or agents of deformations. Just the educated guess is grain boundaries are important, but we're quite unsure how exactly in detail. That was the end of the first little project. In the second one, I'm going a little bit away from the hot stuff and investigating frictional strength of rocks. So back in the, I think in the 70s, Bailey did a famous series of, well, sliding experiments. He took natural rocks, put them on a table, let them slide with a known force, and he found that no matter what material, all of them seem to have a coefficient of friction of around 0.6, independent of the chemistry, independent of the rock type. The problem here is that if we try to run numerical models, for example, but also stress inversion, slip analysis on natural fault zones, and so on, we need a coefficient of friction of around, let's say, 0.2 to make them work. So where, again, is the discrepancy between what we see in nature in those older experiments and what we should or what we require for our models to work? There were several proposals to solve this problem, which is phase decomposition, macroscopic melt formation, frictional heating other than macroscopic melt, so for example flash heating on the grain boundaries, cataclastic flow, and then, well, just what we spoke before, dislocation or diffusion creep. I'm going through all of these to see is it true for olivine. And to do that, I performed experiments together with Nick and Giacomo in Durham. So we've been running deformation experiments at so-called seismic slip rates, which is in between 0.01 meter per second and 1 meter per second. So slip rates you would see on a fault while a seismic event. And in this case, I've been deforming synthetic phosphorite, sol-gel phosphorite, with grain sizes of only 70 nanometers, and two natural olivines from San Carlos and San Bernardino. So three different samples with different chemistries and different grain sizes. Those samples, maybe just to give you a little idea how one of those experiments looks like, that's it. It
it's a few seconds, it's really fast, and that's how it looks like when it fails. So all the powder flying out of there is not supposed to be there. After doing those experiments, again, you get mechanical data. In this case, it's not a stress, but a friction coefficient plotted against the displacement. And those are all the experiments for the synthetic force derived from the 1 meter per second with a grain size of 70 nanometers. And they all follow the same trend or the same stages. You have a very initial phase that you don't really see in the big plot where the friction coefficient quickly rises. Then a second phase with friction coefficient slowly getting to the maximum of around 0.7 or 0.8, which you achieve upon reaching your target speed. Then a third stage in which the friction coefficient quickly drops and then slowly continues, well, to, no, sorry, a third stage where the friction coefficient quickly drops. And a fourth stage where you have a, well, quasi-steady state with slowly decreasing friction coefficients, but in a more or less linear nature. We did it for a lot of different experiments, a total of 30, like I said, three different samples. I'm not going to have time to show them all here, but we can compare it with the literature data. So this part is very important. It's the steady state friction coefficient, again, against the slip rate. So how fast you deform your samples. All of the black, gray, and white symbols are literature data, and the red symbols are my samples, one deformed at 10 to the 0.01 meter per second, and the other time deformed at 1 meter per second. And what you can see here is that at some point, the faster you deform, your friction coefficient suddenly and very significantly drops. So what we have seems to be a rate weakening mechanism at the least. And there's a little set of samples here which falls a little bit of out of line, but those ones are where melting occurs. And also note that there is quite a difference in between single runs, but that's normal for deformation experiments. Now let's look again at the microstructure just by optical microscopy. What you can see that after deformation we have a so-called mirror surface on top of the sample where the highest gradient and in velocity is. So this mirror surface is very fine-grained, it's reflecting light, that's where the name comes from. The starting material, the synthetic nanocrystalline phosphorite, looks like this. Before we deform it, it comes in a powder with, like I said, grain sizes around 70, 80, 90, 100 nanometers, and they do arrange in aggregates. So just by electrostatical forces in between the grains, you aggregate them up. After deformation, you still have a sample with very noticeable grains, and on top of the sample, like I said, you have a mirror surface with a much lower grain size. So just to zoom a little bit from this kind of 3D image into the mirror surface as seen from the top. This is the mirror surface. You have here a window where it's broken, where you can look into the sample. And if you zoom into the mirror surface, you will see all the individual grains that make it up. So it looks well centered, but probably it's not as well centered as we, or as you might think from the first glance. Now, if you look at the whole stack deformed, that's the case of the nanophosphorite. You see here to the left would be the rotating cylinder. So here to the left is the highest gradient in strain. And that's where normally your mirror surface should form. And what we can see is that on this side, we form aggregates in the beginning, which then do disappear towards higher strains. Other than that, there's not much to see. Grain size is 70 nanometers, so it's really approaching the limit of what we can do with the SEM. It's much better if you look at the samples with the bigger grain sizes. Again, highest velocity gradient is to the left. So far away from this gradient, you start with big grains, and towards your potential mirror surface, your grain size gets significantly smaller until you have a sharp boundary towards the outside of the sample. Now, let us go through the possibilities quickly. Phase decomposition and melting both require a lot of heat, and we can also not see any evidences for that in SEM and EBSD. It would be nice to do TEM in the future to really have a close-up look on the grain boundaries to see little bits or little pockets of melt maybe in the junctions. But for now, we have no sign of any form of melting. Other forms of frictional heating, again, in my samples, we don't have clear evidences for that, but Giacomo might talk a little bit more about. Now, cataclastic flow. This is again an SEM image of one of the samples with the bigger grains, and what you do see is that mostly all of the big grains are fractured towards the grain boundary. So you have both fracturing on the one hand, and also the big grains are surrounded by a matrix of really fine grained olivine. Apart from that, well, I zoom again, so your strains, grains start to fracture from the outside going towards the inside and are surrounded by fine grained matrix. And apart from that, we see a formation of a strong SPO. So the initial material starts without any SPO mostly, and in terms of very, very low amounts of deformation, we develop a strong CPO like this, with the grains oriented parallel to the shear direction. And both from the fracturing, the small grained matrix, the formation of a CPO, and the destruction of the CPO, so we start with a low CPO, and then the further we progress in deformation, the CPO gets reduced, we can conclude that, well, cataclastic flow is quite likely. You may ask, what about dislocation creep, diffusion creep? So last plot, and this one, the strain rate against the stress. This one is similar to the literature flow law data I plotted before. So the two solid lines are just random, semi-random literature flow laws I chose, which is not much important because the literature is here. My samples are there. And that's about, let me see, 21 orders of magnitude in difference. So no matter which flow law you like the most, you won't achieve the strain rates we saw in our experiments. So it seems highly unlikely that dislocation creep, diffusion creep, or any of the traditional mechanisms is responsible for that. To summarize that up, we see a rate weakening and probably thermally activated process. This process is effective to very high strains, so we achieved strains of above 10 to the 3. And it's no classic deformation mechanism. With classic, I mean dislocation, creep, diffusion, creep, grain boundary sliding, and so on. And at least from what we can see, it's likely to be cataclastic flow. To summarize both of those projects up and little parts that I didn't speak about, what I provided in my PhD is fully characterized data sets and mechanical strength for all olivine and corresponding microstructures. Also the dislocation density and, in the future, disclination densities as a function of finite strain or stress, and the frictional strength of olivine under seismic slip rates. What we do see in those experiments is that the mechanical strength is not directly correlated to defect density, at least not in an easy way that we can tell. Faults could exhibit a natural self-lubricating process, allowing them basically to slide more easily and to limit the maximum energy released during earthquakes. And just, well, olivine does not behave like what we expect from the metallurgic, from the material sciences literature from the past. And to conclude with the last slide, just going back in scale to the Earth with the stresses that we see in our experiments, if we extrapolate them to temperatures and strain rates common for the lithospheric mantle, we achieve strengths of uppermost mantle rocks of around 0.5 to 1 GPa, which is enough to keep origins isostatically afloat for geological timescales of millions of years. Again, a little shout out. The creep network is working well. We're having several papers in collaboration, one with Lin Feng, one with Giacomo, so happy about it. With that, thank you for your attention.